And that are beginning to make an impact.
Yeah, each of them in their last two games, actually, as Wesleyan hasn't played since a week ago Saturday against Carthage, and their guy, Yoder, Luke Yoder, had a kind of a breakout game in that. He had 26 points and a big win over Carthage. Handed Carthage their first loss of the season. And for the Vikings, Jack Jellin, Thursday night against McMurray, had 23 points in just 20 minutes of action.
Jack McDonald.
Jack McDonald, sorry. I'm sure I'll do that a few times this year. Jack McDonald, the Vikings freshman, had 23 points in 20 minutes in kind of his coming out, at least as far as scoring. He's seen plenty of time on the floor. As you said, another similarity.
And then finally, we talk about similarities between these two teams. They both have kind of gone the transfer route, and they have transfers that are making an immediate impact, similar to their freshmen that we talked about.
Yeah, Vikings junior college transfers that we've talked about, Jacob Pauley and Justin Bodorf, both getting about 17, 18 minutes a game off the bench. Both have performed well so far. Very similar numbers, actually, for the two. Six and a half to 7 points a game, and shooting the ball well, both of them. And then for Illinois Wesleyan, they got the big Division I transfer, Keandre Schumacher, from Winthrop, and he's been as good as advertised for them, 16.3 points a game, shooting 52% from the field, 55% from three-point range. They also have another transfer on their roster, although Alex O'Neill has been in the Titan program now for several years. He originally started out at Creighton, I believe.
So between Keandre Schumacher and Grant Wolf, Vikings going to have their hands full behind the arc today defending that.
I would think so. And interestingly enough, you look at their statistics, they are the only two that have really lit it up from beyond the arc. So hopefully, if you can identify those two, we'll hopefully be able to slow them down a little bit. Doing a little a presentation here at halftime. Steve Allen, who is a executive member of the IBCA, the Illinois Basketball Coaches Association, is recognizing Augie as one of the seven NCAA schools in the state of Illinois to have won 1,500 games. So they're here today, and in conjunction with that, he's also honoring Greg Giovanni for his 500th win and winning the Herons Award, which is an award handed out by the IBCA. So that's the current ceremony that's going on now before our jump ball. And interesting, Steve Allen, the representative here from the IBCA, was Pearson Wofford's high school basketball coach.
Wow. So there's the presentation being made to Coach Gray Giovanni.
Actually, two of the seven NCAA programs with 1,500 wins are going to be on the court today, as Illinois Wesleyan is a member of that group as well. For anyone that's interested, that list entering this season included the University of Illinois with 1,790 wins, McHenry with 1,710, Bradley with 1,669 wins. Illinois Wesleyan came into the season with 1,663 wins. Illinois State was at 1638, Augustana at 1562, and Southern Illinois at 1543. So that's it. Seven NCAA programs in the state that have reached 1,500 wins.
Wow. Pretty impressive that Illinois Wesleyan and Augustana are both members of that.
And has been in the national postseason a total of 28 times.
And then just mentioning there, if you can't hear it, that Vikings have been in the postseason 28 times.
Basketball Coaches Hall of Fame, Jim Borcherding in 1988, and
running down the list, and of course, Gray is already in the IBCA Hall of Fame as a member.
Coach G will also be receiving IBCA recognition as the organization's Parent Award winner, as well as logging his 500 collegiate coaching victory, which came on December 7th versus Carroll.
So a big hand there, a standing ovation for Coach G and his accomplishments and the Vikings as a whole to get to that 1,500.
Rick Kessner, Brent Shreves, and Dave Anderson.
All right, well, we are about
3 minutes
away from tip here as we wrap up the presentation there at the half court. So let's get back, Dan, and talk a little bit about, we always talk about keys to the game for the Vikings today. We talked a little bit before we went on air. Certainly turnovers has to be the one thing that the Vikings need to take care of today.
No question. They were much better the other night against McMurray in kind of a ragtag game. Only turned it over 12 times, which was good news. That's going to be a key. I would say another key is keeping Illinois Wesleyan off the offensive glass. This is, at least statistically, it's been a little bit different Illinois Wesleyan team. They generally shoot the ball exceptionally well from three-point range, and they've shot it fairly well this year, but averaging a shade under 8 three-pointers a game and shooting it at shade under 37%. But what they have done is gone to the offensive glass. They have 112 offensive rebounds on the year. And as we know, in one of the Vikings' two losses this year down at Wash U, that was something that really hurt the Vikings, was the inability to keep the Bears off the glass. So I think you want to obviously avoid a replay of that today. Just to give you an idea, Chris, Illinois Wesleyan has grabbed 36% of their own misses this year, which is the high in the CCIW. Now, comparing CCIW stats at this early in the season is a little bit tricky because everybody's played different schedules and different strengths of schedules, obviously, but that is by a significant margin the highest number in the CCIW that they grabbed 36% of their own misses. So I think that'll be a real key, along with limiting the turnovers for the Vikings.
We've always talked all year long, too, about other teams, how they've defended Micah Martin. Illinois Wesleyan comes equipped. Certainly, they can go one-on-one with Charlie Bear against Micah Martin, but they can also double-team. What do you see the Titans doing there?
They'll probably mix it up, I would imagine. I would be surprised. And the fact is, the Vikings rotating three big men in all the time. You know, Micah's not out there all that much. He's averaging 22 minutes a game, so he's out there more than Donovan or Roman Youngblood. So I think if you have a specific plan for Micah, you're almost going to have to mix up your defense because he's going to be off the floor nearly half the time.
Well, we look here. We got a preview of the starting lineups, and Grant Wolf is in for Illinois Wesleyan, as we suspected, as he comes back to play for the Titans. So the Vikings will bring their freshman, Jack McDonald, off the bench, and the Titans will have their freshman in Luke Yoder available off the bench too, which certainly will make things interesting and fun. All right, we are about just less than 30 seconds away from the tip here. Expect this to be a good one. Again, the 172nd meeting between these two teams. The only team that's the most that the Vikings have played against any one team. I believe Illinois Wesleyan has played Millikan 230 times, so actually the Vikings the second most for the Titans, if you look at it from that historical perspective. All right, well, right now we are going to stand as the rest of the crowd here at the Carver Center gets prepared, and we'll honor America with the playing of the national anthem.
Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, we ask that you please rise for our national anthem this afternoon, performed by Matthew Husma.
Into the Carver PE Center for some Sunday afternoon CCIW basketball, and it's a good one as the Titans of Illinois Wesleyan come in at 6-3 to take on the Augustana 6-2, and the Vikings also at 6-2, so it should be a dandy. Right now, let's meet the starting lineups for that, and I'll send it right back to Dan Sand.
All right, Chris, I want to give a shout-out to Matt Postma, our student who sang the national anthem and did a great job, as always. For Illinois Wesleyan, as you mentioned, Chris, they come in 6-2 overall, 1-1 in the CCIW. Their lineup's going to look like this. Number two, Peter Lambesis, 6'4", 195, and a sophomore from St. Viator High School in Mount Prospect, Illinois. Number 11 is Keandre Schumacher, 5'11", 175, and a sophomore from Bloomington, Illinois, U High, and the University of Winthrop. Number 24 is Grant Wolf, 5'11", 185, and a junior from Effingham High School in Effingham, Illinois. Number 25 is Doug Wallen, 6'5", 210, and a junior from Champaign Central High School in Champaign, Illinois. And in the middle for the Titans, number 50, Charlie Bear, 6'7", 220, and a junior from Glen Ellyn, Illinois, and Glen Bard South High School. For the Vikings, Chris, lineup is going to look the same as it has the last few games. Number 12, Jack Jellin, 5'10", 176, and a junior from Bay Village, Ohio, and Bay High School. Number 22 is Austin Ellidge, 6'1", 167, and a senior from Highland High School in Highland, Illinois. Number 23, Lucas Simon, 6'5", 173, and a senior from Notre Dame High School in Chicago, Illinois. Number 24, Pearson Wofford, 6'3", 198, and a senior from Springfield, Illinois, and Springfield Lutheran High School, and in the middle for the Vikings. Number 44, Micah Martin, 6'11", 242, a senior from Iowa City High in Iowa City, Iowa. Vikings led by head coach Gray Giovanni in his 21st year at Augustana, where he has a record of 421 and 144 for a 745 winning percentage. CCIW mark, 203 and 84 for a 707 winning percentage.
Very good. Thank you, Dan. Big crowd on hand and a lot of Titan green behind the Titan benches. Titan fans have traveled well from Bloomington.
Sorry, Chris, we didn't talk too much individually in the pregame. We talked about the backcourt of the Titans. We didn't mention Charlie Garrett comes in averaging 10.3 rebounds a game, so he would be the main guy, 36 of those offensive. So he's averaging 4.5 offensive rebounds a game, so real key to keep him off the offensive glass tonight or this afternoon. We don't play a lot of day games.
Nope, Sunday afternoon game, the first of three in a row for the Vikings, which is definitely an oddity. All right, here we go. It's what we've waited for, the Titans and the Vikings in the new season here. Martin and Bear in the center circle. Ball is up and the Vikings will control it. Jack Jellin with the ball picked up by Wolf. Jack gets in the lane, going to get a wide open look for Lucas Simon, and that's good news as the Vikings get a good clean look for Lucas. No hesitation, and he drops it in.
Well, we've talked about how well the Vikings have shot it recently. Last five games, 59% from the field and 49% from three-point range.
Wolf back off of injury. That with the ball there for the Titans goes down low to Bear. Big time matchup there. And now Wolf gets it back, splits the double team, and we'll get the easy layup. Little defensive breakdown there by the Vikings on that wing screen.
Right, they got Micah playing out away from the basket. Once Yoder split that, he had a free reign to the basket.
That was Wolf, yep.
What did I say?
You said Yoder. It's all right.
Thinking ahead.
That's right. Titans. Inside to Micah Martin. Wow, he'll reverse it and score.
And the Titans, Chris, were in a 2-3 zone that time down the court, so I didn't think Ron Rose would make me look that good when I said they'd mix up their defense and do it on their first two possessions.
Walling out on top now, guarded by Pearson Wofford. Another good matchup there. All around good matchups. Again, Wolf, second take to the bucket, and you can see the impact that Grant Wolf has. Their leading scorer, and he's got their first two buckets. It's 5-4. And they really extend Lambesis out there. Lucas Simon is open in the corner if they can get him the ball quickly. Little short pass into Wofford. He'll fade away. Pearson Wofford gets his bucket. That's the Vikings' leading scorer. He comes in averaging just over 15 points per game in about 25 minutes. 7-4, Augustana, with about a minute and a half gone by. Lambesis in the lane, going to give it up. Bear now puts down. Pivots in the lane, goes up with the left hand, had it partially blocked. Out of bounds, it'll be Viking ball.
Micah Martin with the block there. Micah's 18th block of the season.
Micah is so much more effective when he stays down on defense. We've talked about that for years.
Yep. We talked about Bears' rebounding prowess. He has not shot it very well this year, just 37% out of a post player.
Zone extended by the Titans here now. Vikings work it across and get into the half court set there. Schumacher out on top on Ellidge, and Jellin, before he could get the baseline take, stepped out of bounds in front of the Titan bench. First Viking turnover.
I'm amazed by how much you see that in today's game, Chris. The court's the same size it's always been.
Well, I think teams are trying to spread the court, so guys are used to extending way out there.
It's a good idea to stay on the court,
You
though.
See it in your Division I, you see it in the NBA. I agree. I'm not sure
I don't
the
see it in the NBA because I don't watch it. But
you are correct. 2.5 gone by. Augie with a three-point lead here, 7-4. Lambesis in the corner now picks up his dribble. Wofford going to get on him. Finds help in Bear. 10 on the shot clock now. Bear wide open. Oh, he missed a good opportunity as they moved the ball to well. Wallen going to take the three out of the corner and got it to go. Really surprised Charlie Bear didn't take that initial shot.
But like I said, doesn't, at least numbers-wise, doesn't appear to be a big offensive threat.
I think anybody's a threat when they catch it down that low.
You would think.
Tied at 7 apiece now.
It's tight and staying in that zone. They were man-to-man on the first possession.
Wofford going to get his second bucket of the night with a deep penetration just outside the lane.
Neither team not having much success stopping the other at this point.
Early lead to the Vikes at 9-7. Schumacher now going to give it down to Wallen. He'll go to work on Wofford. Wallen fades away with the left hand. That is a tough shot. Tied at 9 now. As you mentioned, Illinois Wesleyan not played for 8 days, so credit them. They've come out looking pretty sharp here. Jellin goes far side now to Simon back on top. Jack's going to load for the three, a little bit too hard. Rebound going to go to Wofford, but he's going to get called for the push.
First wave of substitutions for the Vikings.
First foul on either team there. Excuse me, Dan.
Ferguson, McDonald, and Pauly into the game for the Vikings.
Jacob Pauly, one of those key transfers we talked about. Went to Geneseo High School here locally and then Blackhawk College. And we got a first look at him really last year in a JV game when Blackhawk played our JV guys, and he was quite impressive.
Actually came out of high school as a baseball recruit.
Wolf again to the bucket, can't get it to go. Pauly with the rebound. Jack McDonald with the ball for the Vikings, coming off his career high against McMurray. Ellidge going to step back on the baseline and around and out. Ferguson with the offensive rebound, and he'll draw the foul on Charlie Bear, I believe. Nope, check that on Doug Wallen.
The foul is on Doug Wallen. His first team foul.
So one team foul apiece. And Donovan Ferguson, just a 40% free throw shooter to the line for the Vikings.
Get on that first one.
Corey Noe into the ball game along with Alex O'Neill. O'Neill, a 6'9", 245-pound senior. And Noe, a 6'2 sophomore out of Muhammad Seymour. Two-point ball game now in favor of the Vikings, 15-50 to play in the first half.
Yeah, O'Neill started 15 of 27 games for the Titans last year, but his role has diminished a little bit as Ron Rose has seemingly gone with a little bit smaller lineup.
Lambis is going to kick it out. Wallen got the wide open look. Kind of flat shot, but it was good.
Too open a look, yep. And that's going to draw a timeout from Coach G.
So Coach G and the Vikings call a 30-second timeout. I believe that's the first lead of the day for the Titans as they lead 12-11 with 15:34 to play. Well, our live stats are down, so we can't give you shooting percentages, but I got to believe they're very good for both teams, Dan.
I can remember the Vikings missing one shot, and I think maybe the Titans have missed one. Good news for the Vikings, Chris, is if they don't have to worry about the Titans keeping the Titans off the offensive glass if they can't make them miss a shot here and there.
Yeah, that's. I'd rather have to have them worry.
Yeah.
All right, 15:34 to go as we come out of the 32nd Augustana timeout. Titans lead by one.
Now mixing it up more, going with a little three-quarter court pressure.
McDonald going to get over half court. Now he'll set for the Vikings. We're going to get a foul on Lambesis as Ellidge tried to penetrate the gap there. Second foul on the Titans, first on Peter Lambesis.
Number two.
Now we'll get a little, nope, they're gonna stay in the zone. Thought we were gonna get some man-to-man. Ellard's gonna again take that same mid-range jumper. That one goes also. Ellard has four now, and the Vikings back on top 13-12. Wolf now looks, finds the cutting Lambesis in the lane. He'll square up with the left hand. Soft touch, no good. Rebound to Ferguson. McDonald on the push now for the Vikings. Goes far side. Going to be double teamed in the corner, and that causes the turnover. O'Neal picks it up, gives it right back to Wolf. Wolf going to go all the way to the bucket. He'll kick it off. Long shot up and good. That's a three by Peter Lambesis.
Vikings have given up a couple wide open looks from three-point range here in the early going.
Two-point Titan lead. Just short of 6 minutes gone by. Real tight Titan zone here so far. Ellich, they force him off the line. He'll again take the mid-range jumper. And Austin Ellich having his way from mid-range.
It's interesting, Chris. If you look in recent series, in this recent series, quite often, as Wolf drives again.
Big time battle for the board. Wofford pulls it down. Go ahead, Dan.
The general way games quite often have played out is the Titans run out to an early lead and the Vikings have been stronger later. And we'll see if that holds true today.
Long three by Wofford. Wolf on the run out. Now got caught under the bucket. Ball knocked out of bounds by Lambesis. And it'll go to the Vikings.
Subs for both teams, Chris.
If Justin Bottoff will see his first action for the Vikings, Jack Jellin back in. Jared Tribble in for the first time, joins Micah Martin. And we'll look
Yoder and Cody Mitchell, their top two freshmen in for the Titans.
Charlie Bear also back in. Yeah, Yoder number four, the freshman we talked about. We didn't talk a lot about Cody Mitchell, but we will here.
Teammate, high school teammate of Viking freshman Nate Ortiz at St. Charles East.
Eight on the shot clock now as Pauly in the corner kicks out on top to Bottorff. Tries to force it inside to Martin, knocked away. No on the run out now. Stops, leaves it behind for Bear. He'll direct some traffic now. Backdoor cut by Yoder, kicked out on top. Mitchell. Back to Lambesis. He'll work on the fadeaway. Shot up, no good, missed everything. And saved, but not saved, by Jacob Pauly.
And I think if Jacob had just let that one go, it would have been Viking ball.
Keandre Schumacher will check back in. He'll give Lambesis a rest. 12:45 to play here in the first half. We are tied at 15.
Refs officials are talking over a shot clock adjustment. We're going to say the Vikings had possession, so they reset it at 30.
Bear, top of the key to Schumacher. Good ball movement there. Mitchell takes it baseline, dumps it to Bear, misses the layup, and then out of bounds. A good opportunity missed there by the Titans as they work that play well. Jellin weaves his way up the floor, goes far side now.
See if the Vikings can get a better possession this time. Not a very good possession last time down the court.
Good pass inside. Up and good by Micah Martin. Jellin made a nice pass. Micah didn't get the handle the first time. He controlled it, but fortunately got it back, recovered, and got up a shot, and then was fouled.
Got Mitchell on the foul, Chris.
So a three-point play, the old-fashioned way for the Vikings. And they're back to an 18-15 lead now as Lucas Simon checks back in. Now the Vikings will provide a little full court pressure of their own here. This one's man-to-man, and they get it into Yoder. He'll work on Jellin. Past the timeline now. And Yoder will set the Titan offense. Knocked away by Jellin, and the ball goes out of bounds. It'll stay with the Titans. 15 on the shot clock now. Schumacher going to stop and pop. That one goes. Wow, that's a tough shot.
55% will be on the arc, Chris, so I imagine he's done that before.
Squared up in a hurry and got it to go, tied at 18. Jelen now on the rush, goes cross-court to Tribble. Kick out, Bodorf going to get a look at a three. No good, rebound pulled down by Mitchell, taken away by the Vikings, and we're going to get a foul on the Titans. So that time, Micah just a little brute strength there to take it away. The second foul will go on Mitchell.
Yeah, I would say, Chris, in the first about 8.5 minutes of this one, the Vikings have certainly more than held their own on the boards. And now a rare, careless turnover there by Lucas Simon.
Mitchell with the crossover. Back to no, now Yoder. Schumacher works on Tribble. Good matchup with two really quick guys right there. Step back, long three, no good by no. Rebound to the Vikings. Jelen weaves his way through some traffic, stops just past the elbow, puts up the jumper, and it's good. 2018, the Vikings, and a 30-second timeout now called by Ron Rose. So it's been a tight one throughout. Both teams, I think, shooting well. Turnovers has not been a big issue for either team, Dan.
No, I think the keys that we pointed to in the pregame, turnovers and keeping the Titans off the boards, the Vikings have both done a nice job of that here in the early going. As you mentioned, both teams shooting it well. I think the Vikings' challenge thus far is to A, keep Grant Wolf out of the lane, and B, not give up the wide open three-pointers. The Titans have got a couple of three really good open looks. The last one by Schumacher, I would not put in that category. That was just a tough shot by a very good shooter.
11:05 to play here, first half, Vikings by two. Wolf back into the ball game. And Lambesis back in, along with Doug Wallen. Nice pass to Wallen. He'll sweep the left-handed hook. I don't think Micah got any target.
I don't think he did, but he certainly affected it.
Elledge going to get a wide-open look from the corner. No good. Rebound, Wallen. Ball knocked loose, tipped away. Elledge going to come up with a loose ball. So right now, the Vikings getting the 50-50 balls.
Titans now back to man, looks like.
Elledge with the spin move. Simon ready to catch and shoot. No good. Rebound, Schumacher. Wolf goes far side to Lambesis now. He'll work just inside the free throw lane. His shot up, no good. Micah Martin with a rebound. Jelen around the Martin screen. Now he's going to leave it behind for Elledge. Deep inside. The Vikings turn it over again, trying to force it inside. Bear going to get the run out pass, and now he looks for help and finds it in Schumacher. They run him off the three-point line. Good pass. Now Wolf on the far side will reset for the Titans. That time, they're going to get a foul on Jelen. Wow, that's a tough call there. Jack dove in on Schumacher to try to get the ball right in front of the Augie bench. But Jack will pick up his first foul in the second for the Vikings.
Number two.
Jack McDonald in, back in. I should say Donovan Ferguson back in. We get our first look at Matt Laritz, 6'7 sophomore, as he'll come in and play that five spot for the Titans.
Another very good rebounder, Chris. Get out of the St. Louis area.
Schumacher now with five on the clock. Wolf thought about the shot. Works off Jack McDonald. Can't get the three to go. Still a two-point Augustana lead, 9:15 to play here, first half. McDonald to the bucket, stopped by Wolf, kicked back out on top. Vikings reset. Now we're going to get a kind of a touch foul there called on Wallen.
Yeah, I would say they have called, although we haven't had a lot of fouls called, I would say they've called it pretty tight so far. There's been some fouls that didn't look like, at least from our vantage point, there was a whole lot of contact.
I know they want the both hands on the waist called this year, but that one looked like Wallen just had a hand on the hip, one hand. So
yeah, the both hands on is kind of a by rule automatic thing.
So the Vikings get it back. Wofford going to take The three-point shot, no good. Another long rebound to Pauly. Back inside to Wofford. He'll go cross-court, skip pass to Elledge. He works in the lane. Another mid-range jump, and he's got eight.
Yeah, he loves that little kind of mid-range fadeaway.
Four-point Augie lead now, under 9 minutes to play first half. Good one here cooking in Rock Island, as you would expect from the Titans and the Vikings. Schumacher going to go down low to Laritz. He squares up on Donovan Ferguson, now throws up the little jump hook. Got a nice bounce and got it to go. Laritz on the board for his first points.
Titans back to the zone.
Making the Vikings think about it. Pauly's going to load the three. No good. Rebound. Pearson Wofford right there. Vikings getting some second chance opportunities today.
It's been the Vikings who have been who have done the damage on the offensive glass here in the early going, Chris.
4-point Augie lead as we hit the 8-minute mark now with the first half. Ambesis now picked up the dribble looking for help. Wofford extended on Charlie Bear, and he'll pick up the foul.
Second on Pearson, so that one hurts a little bit. So we've still got almost 8 minutes to play.
Corey Noe back into the ball game for Schumacher. Justin Bodorf back in for the Vikings. Fifteen on the shot clock now as Wolf goes far side to Lambesis. Laritz down low to Bear. Got to respect him out there. He will put up that shot. Now three on the clock. No in the lane. The little running left-hander. No good. Bear's going to get called for the offensive foul as he pushed Bodorf to the ground there to gain advantage for the rebound. First on Bear.
16 foul on the Titans.
This first team foul, number six.
Now back to the three-quarter court.
Vikings haven't, well, neither team's had problems with the other team's pressure, so far so good.
No, I think it's more just trying to give your opponent a different look.
Triple steps through to McDonald. He'll take the three. No good. Another offensive rebound for the Vikings. That's Bodorf.
And Chris, you notice that he kicked it back to McDonald. So I wondered against McMurray the other night if that was a strategy for the Vikings, and that makes me wonder even more.
Another long three by Paul. This one good.
Vikings have missed several threes in a row. I think Lucas hit that one on the first possession. I'm not sure the Vikings have hit one since. So good to see him get the lid off from beyond the arc.
Biggest lead of the night for either team, and it's the Vikings by seven now, with just over 6.5 to play here in the Carver PE Center. Wolf now going to get a look for three. That one around and out. Rebound ripped down by Micah Martin. McDonald on the push now, goes far side to Pauly. Right back to McDonald, and the Vikings go to work in the half-court set. McDonald, that's basically a free throw.
Yeah,
missed everything.
He shot it out of rhythm, Chris. If he could just come around the screen and shot it, I think he'd been about a lot better off.
Wolf right back the other way, leaves it for Noe. He'll run the baseline and wanted to pop it out on the other side to Lambesis, but called for the turnover as he stepped on the end line.
You'd like to see Chris Hope, you know, that little confidence of that big game that Jack had the other night rub off there and him, you know, shoot that with some confidence coming off that curl.
32nd timeout here for Ron Rose. We talked about the history on these two teams, Dan. I don't know if a lot of people know how the connection between Ron Rose and Gray Giovanni. From what I could gather through Gray and through the internet, Gray was at Valpo as an assistant coach and actually recruited Ron Rose at Valpo initially.
Unsuccessfully, apparently.
Well, and then he left midway through the season, went to Illinois Wesleyan for 4 years. But then they also reconnected, and I think they were both on Scott Thompson's staff at Wichita State. So we talk about the history between the two programs.
No, and I did not realize that Ron Rose didn't start off at Illinois Wesleyan.
Yeah. All right, back here, 6:03 to play, and a 7-point Augustana lead, and they have the ball here.
This is the first time we've seen the two freshmen actually going head-to-head, Chris, Yoder and McDonald.
Triple, kicks out to McDonald, and the shot's good, but we'll wave it off as we're going to get a foul on Jared Triple as he crashed into a tight player. There's our live stats. So Vikings 11 of 21 from the floor for 52%. Titans 8 of 21 for 38. They are
Viking. Yeah, I was going to say the Vikings have struggled from beyond the arc, 2 of 10, where the Titans have been a pretty crisp 4 of 7. So tale of two shooting halves for each team. Vikings getting it done inside the arc and the Titans from beyond.
Wolf now behind the arc, teasing Bottorf there. Lambesis in the lane, squares up, and we're going to get a late whistle on Lucas Simon. Lucas thought he got the ball, but we'll get a foul called. And Peter Lambesis will head to the free throw line for the Titans.
Yeah, that's one of those situations where you got it pretty well defended. You know, maybe don't try and swat for that blocked shot. Just make it a tough shot. Lambesis 71% on the year, 20 at 28.
Dan, the Vikings have turned it over more than I would have thought. 6 turnovers.
Well,
just one for the Titans.
They've had a couple offensive fouls, and of course those go as turnovers too. You sometimes don't think of them that way, but the last possession, Jared Triple picked up the charge. That's a turnover.
Doug Wallen back into the game for Bear. And then they've tried to force it into Micah Martin a couple times, and the Titans have just got in the passing lane there. So something the Vikings need to continue to work on here. Just over 5 minutes to play. Triple with the step back, and that will be another turnover. Elledge, Wofford, and Jellin back in for the Vikings. Bottorf, McDonald, and Triple will take a rest. Wallen has 8 for the visiting Titans. Vikings led by Wofford and Elledge, who have 6 apiece. 5 minutes to go now as Wolf tries to split the double team. Can't do it. Vikings pick up the turnover. Elledge now to Simon. Lucas back to Elledge. He fakes the long three, and now he'll take the 15-footer. Got it to go, and Elledge has 8 now. Excellent shooting from the field for Austin Elledge. 4 of 6. Yoder in the lane, kicks it out to O'Neal. Now Lambesis on the big run, runs right into Micah Martin. Micah with a good tiptoe save to Elledge, and here come the Vikings on the attack, up by 7. Simon can make it 10 with a 3. That one off the rim, no good. Good rebound inside by Wofford. Has it blocked, though, by Lambesis. Big time block
and
there.
Again, I've said it so many times, Chris, Pearson seemed more interested in drawing. Nice defensive play there by Austin Elledge to take that ball out of bounds. But Pearson seemed more interested in drawing the contact than just getting a bucket.
So a couple turnovers in a row for the Titans. The Vikings have the rock back with a 7-point lead. Now Jellin off the ankle as Pearson races it across the timeline. 4 minutes to play now in the half. Both teams 6-2, and the Vikings, obviously, we've talked about how important it is to hold serve on the home court. Yeah, another turnover there by Micah Martin this time. O'Neal looks for the backdoor cut to Yoder. Good defense by Elledge. Wallen at the baseline, the free throw line. Little shoulder shimmy, no good. So some good stops here by the Vikings. Elledge going to take the three, no good. Rebound pulled down by O'Neal.
So the Vikings, as I said, 49% from beyond the arc in the last 5 games. Just 2 of 12 here in the first half. So I think a pretty good sign that they're still up 7.
Yoder gets his first look with Micah Martin up close as he goes down in the lane. And now we're going to get a push on Alex O'Neal.
Wow, that's a break for the Vikings as Wesleyan obviously had the mismatch with Jack Jellin trying to front O'Neal, and O'Neal gets called for the push off.
7th team foul on the Titans, first on O'Neal. McDonald and Ferguson back in. Lambesis back in. Schumacher back in for the Titans. And Charlie Bear. I'm not sure I expected to see Bear and O'Neal in the ballgame at the same time. We'll see how this one works out for the Vikings.
Bear's played some 4 for him, I think.
Bot Orfron off the arc, out on top, McDonald.
Very good.
Jack McDonald makes it a 10-point ball game now as we go under three to play. 32-22. McDonald's first bucket of the game. Off the curl is Lambesis. He'll fade away. No good. Knocked out of bounds, though, by Bodorf as he tried to hold off Charlie Bear there. Yeah, just taking a rebounding advantage. Huge in the Viking favor, 21-8. You don't have to point that out. You can just say it.
Didn't want to jinx anything, Chris.
Three in the corner, and that'll go by Corey No. And Elledge tries to run out, leaves it up for Ferguson. No good. Donovan gets it back, puts it right back up and in.
Not quite the way they drew it up, Chris, but they got it done. Another offensive rebound. Well, I guess that wouldn't be an offensive rebound if that didn't have that initial catch.
Ferguson now has four. Vikings 50% from the field, now 14 of 28. Long three up and perfect by Corey No as he starts to heat up.
Tight and staying within reach in this one by knocking down threes.
No, two of three now behind the arc, and it's a 6-point ball game at the 2-minute mark. Good one here at the Carver Center. Just as you would expect out of these two teams. Lucas Simon, little runner in the lane, around and out, no good. And we're going to get a basket interference on the Vikings. That'll go on Donovan Ferguson. So a 30-second timeout called by Coach G as he wants to make sure the Vikings finish correctly here, not let the Titans get in any closer, as the Vikings had led by 10, but a couple of big threes by Corey No. And it's back to a close six-point ball game.
Yeah, to sum this one up, basically the Vikings have shot it very well inside the arc. The Titans have shot it very well outside the arc. Augie's dominated the boards, but has turned it over eight times to just four for the Titans. So, but each team has their positives here in the first half.
Elledge leads the Vikings with eight. Doug Wallen has eight for the Titans. Titans 10 of 26 from the field for 38.5%. 6 of 9, though, for the Titans, 67% from behind the arc.
Right, so 4 of 17 inside the arc for Illinois Wesleyan.
Back to action here with 1:45 to go. Wolf going to get it up the floor and finds No. Now another wide open look for Yoder, and the 3-point shot is starting to fall for the Titans. That's three in a row now, and it's a 3-point ball game. Simon now far side. Comes near to Bodorf. He'll put up the three. No good off the rim. Wolf, the smallest guy on the floor, pulls down the rebound. He's going to take it coast to coast, but not before he gets fouled by Lucas Simon.
16 fouls. The Titans not shooting yet.
Lucas Simon. And second. Team foul. Number six.
The Titans came in shooting 37% from three-point land. Right now, they've doubled that as they're shooting 7 of 10 for 70%. Yoder puts it in, and it's going to be a slam for O'Neill as the Vikings fell asleep on defense there. And it's a 1-point ball game now with just over a minute to play. See if the Vikings can settle down here and get a good offensive set here. Elledge going to go right at the chest of the defender. No good. Tipped around, missed by Bodorf. And now a run out in the corner for Wolf. He tracks it down, gets it to Bear. And with 45 seconds to play, the Titans have it again. And Bear's going to go right to the bucket, misses the layup, but draws the foul on Bodorf. Boy, the Viking defense just left Charlie Bear all alone.
Yeah, Bodorf got way too far out, Chris, trying to challenge the passing lane there, and all he had to do was go right by him.
So Bear heads to the free throw line, a 69% free throw shooter. Bodorf will check out. Carson Frakes checks in. We get our first look at Carson. Another guy that's just really healthy for the Vikings for the first time. Second one short. Pauly pulls down the rebound. Tied at 34 with about an 11-second difference between the first half clock and the shot clock. See what the Vikings do here. Jelen going to kick it out on top to Frakes. Back to Elledge, 15 on the shot clock. Elledge going to take that jumper again. No good. Vikings have gone cold. Titans have lit it up from behind the arc here in the last 3 minutes.
Well, you know what, Chris? Lighting it up from, you can be upset about lighting it up from behind the arc, but I think Coach G would probably be more upset by the two breakdowns that allowed the Titans to, A, get a dunk off an inbounds play, and then that, that block by Yoder. I think more upsetting is the breakdown defensively that gave them a dunk and then the missed overplay on the lane that allowed Bear to go uncontested to the basket. I think that's more troubling than the three-point shots falling.
So the first half comes to an end. We are tied at 34 in a game that the Vikings led by 10 midway through, or three-quarters of the way through the first half. To credit the Titans as they fought back and tied this one up. We'll take a break, get you some stats. We'll be back with more Augustana basketball right after this.
Is it riskier to build your way to growth or buy your way? We have ideas. Find them at wehaveideas.firstmidwest.com. First Midwest Bank.
Welcome back into the Carver PE Center. Chris Ford, Dan Sand with you. Halftime here between the Titans and the Vikings. And we are tied at 34. And Dan, balanced scoring for both teams, about the same shooting percentage, so you would assume a very close ball game.
Right. The big difference is the Titans' shooting has come from beyond the arc tonight as they hit 7 of 10 in the first half. Running down their totals, they had Doug Wallen with 8 points. Corey Noe had 6, 5 for Peter Lambesis, 4 for Grant Wolf, 3 for Keandre Schumacher, 3 for Luke Yoder, 2 each for Matthew Laritz and Alex O'Neill, and 1 for Charlie Baird to round out their total of 34. The Titans were 12 of 29 from the field for 41%, but 7 of 10 from beyond the arc, 70%. They hit 3 of 4 free throws for 75%. Looking at the Vikings, Chris, after 5 games of hot shooting, they finally cooled off a little bit here. They're shooting 41% in the first half as well on 14 of 34, and just 3 of 15 from beyond the arc after hitting 49% over their last 5 games. Vikings were 3 of 3 from the free throw line in the first half. Individually, Vikings led by Austin Ellidge with 8. Pearson Wofford had 6. Micah Martin, 5. 4 for Donovan Ferguson. 3 each for Lucas Simon, Jack McDonald, and Jacob Pauley. And 2 for Jack Jelland to round out the Vikings' total of 34. Looking at the team stats, Vikings getting it done on the boards. 25 rebounds to 13 advantage over the Titans. So that's really a statistic that goes in the Vikings' favor, including 9 offensive rebounds, which has led to 11 second-half points, so all good numbers there. Turnovers, 8 for the Vikings, not as high as they've had in some games this year, but still a higher number than you'd ideally like to see. Titans turned it over just 4 times in the first half.
Yeah, I was going to mention how the Vikings had, we kind of been critical all year, the Vikings giving other teams second-chance opportunities, but today it's been the Vikings that have had that with, I think you said, 9 offensive rebounds leading to 11 points. So that's huge for the Vikings. And as you, Vikings have done a nice job, I think, Grant Wolf with just 4.
I think their first 4 points on two drives through the lane, and Schumacher just hit that 1-3. So the Vikings have done a nice job on the two big scorers for Illinois Wesleyan, but Corey Noe in particular hitting threes, and Doug Wallen getting going have kind of paced the Titans in the early going.
The last game against McMurray, Dan and I talked about, I asked Dan kind of a third of the way through the season to grade the Vikings, and one of the things Dan wanted to look at before he got too definitive was offensive efficiencies. If you take a look at what we have up right now, Dan, a little bit better explanation for the Vikings and what's going on.
Yeah, basically we had talked about, the Vikings had shot the ball very well this year, 42% from three-point range and 52% from overall field goals coming in tonight. I said that if you analyze their points per possession, it probably wouldn't reflect that as much as you would expect it to, because the Vikings have been so turnover prone here in the early season, and the little graphic that our producer Kyle Ekberg has put up here indicates that Vikings, although they're second coming in tonight, they were second in the league in field goal percentage and first in three-point percentage, but only 7th out of 9 teams in offensive efficiency. And basically what that is a measure of points per 100 possession. And you can see in the graphic that Kyle put up, Carthage leads the league at 117.5 points per 100 offensive possessions, and the Vikings are down in the 7th slot at 108.2. So that's just the indication of how those turnovers damage you offensively, is even though the Vikings have shot it very well this year, they haven't really, compared to the rest of the league, been a terribly efficient offensive team. So hopefully that turns around a little bit.
Does that change your grade? I think you originally gave the Vikings a B.
I'm not sure I gave them a B. I think I have to go back and look at the archive. I don't recall, but I did comment that probably not as I wouldn't be able to grade them as high as you would think over a team that had shot it as well as they had.
All right, let's take a look at the defensive side of that too. Same scenario, except the Vikings obviously play out a little bit better in this one.
Yeah, the Vikings ranked 3rd in the league, and that's if you go back, what I'll do, I didn't get a chance to do it today, but what I'll do is go back and kind of look historically in the last 5-6 years during the Vikings' really great run that they've put together, where those numbers stack up historically. And like I said, looking at
conference numbers this early in the season are a little tricky because obviously everybody's played different schedules, different strengths of schedules. So I wouldn't put too much stock in them. It was more to just kind of measure what Augustana's performance has been so far. And not surprisingly, pretty good defensively. But on the offensive side, maybe not quite as good as you would think from a team shooting 52% from the field and 42% from three-point range.
But again, the turnovers are the stat in that factor that skew things the wrong way for the Vikings.
Exactly.
Well, as you said, in the first half, the Vikings did a much better job, just 8 turnovers for the Vikings. So that will certainly help here as we get...
Yeah, still a higher number than you would want, ideally. But coming off a game where they had, I think they had 25 against Carroll, you got to take small victories as this team kind of works on that. I had mentioned in the first half too, Chris, that historically, in recent history, the way the Viking-Titan games a lot of times have played out is that the Titans went out to an early lead and the Vikings eventually rallied. And if you look at last year's 3 games, that kind of it's kind of borne out. Last year here at Carver Center, the first of the 3 meetings, Augie trailed 27-26 at halftime and went on to win 67-60. Then you look at the two at the meeting down at Shirk. Vikings led by only 3 at halftime and ended up winning that game by 22. And then back here for the conference tournament last year, Vikings led 39-37 at the break and ended up winning 89-65. So hopefully tonight's game, although you're looking at 2 completely different casts of characters, hopefully for the Vikings' sake, that trend will hold true.
That would be sweet. All right, we are set to start this second half here. It'll be Titan ball. And we'll take a look. Looks like Corey Noe is going to get the start in place of...
And Yoder. Yoder also in.
Yeah, and Yoder. Vikings go with their original 5. Quick 3 up, no good. Missed everything. That was no.
So Lambis is out of the lineup. And let's see who would be...
Schumacher.
Yeah, Lambis and Schumacher out of the lineup. Now we got a foul on the Titans.
So Wolf picks up his first for the Titans. Just seconds here into half number 2.
Like the Titans stay man-to-man. We saw them mix up defenses quite a bit in the first half.
A lot of help there on Wofford. Can't get the shot to go. No pulls down the rebound. Half court. Now they go into the corner to Wallen. He'll go right at the Viking defense, and good job. I think Lucas Simon got that one from behind after Micah Martin built the wall straight up with the body. Good defensive possession there for the Vikings. Elledge on Bear, no work there. Jelen now going to kick back out to Elledge. Almost lost the handle. 10 on the shot clock for the Vikings. Wofford goes cross court. A good look for Lucas Simon, and that 3 will go.
Lucas' second 3 of the night, and he hit one on the Vikings' opening possession of the game.
That cross court pass, or opposite side pass, has been effective for the Vikings. Back to a 3-point lead. No, in the lane now. Backed away. Good hands by Wofford. Simon got a hand on it. Back to the Titans, though. Wallen's 3 up, no good. Tipped around. Now knocked out of bounds by, oh, great save by Wallen.
Wow. That's a frantic segment there.
Good hustle by both teams, but the Titans come up with the loose ball.
Yeah, you like to see the Vikings make several nice plays there, particularly Pearson Wofford getting a hand on it. You like to see the Vikings come away with that.
Yoder going to dump it inside, and shot no good by Bear. That one was halfway down. Vikings on the run. Now Titans get back. Leave behind for Simon. He'll go into the post to Pearson Wofford. He'll square up on Wolf, turns, catches some defense. Good ball movement by the Vikings, then stopped in the hands of Lucas Simon. Martin in the low post goes up, can't get the tip to go. Knocked out of bounds. Nope, tracked down by Grant Wolf. 3-point Augie lead. Wolf now a little hesitation move, blocked by Micah Martin, then stripped by Bear, picked up by Simon.
This game has a completely different vibe here in the second half.
Simon for another 3, no good. Martin with the rebound, and they're going to get a foul called on Micah Martin. So Micah will pick up his first foul, and that'll even the team fouls at 1 apiece. Alex O'Neill and Keandre Schumacher are going to come back in for the Titans.
So a whole lot of action here, Chris, in the first 2.5 minutes, but not much getting done. Just 3 points up on the board on that Luke and Simon three-pointer.
Vikings get Luke Johnson, Carson Frakes, and Pauly into the ballgame. 2.5 gone by here. Vikings by 3 early in the second half.
Luke Yoder gave the head bob there, but was not called for the delay of game. By the way, I was watching, can't remember the game I was watching the other night, and Jay Billis was on the call, and he was stealing my shtick. He was talking about the only reason that the game was delayed is because they blow the whistle. I've been saying that since the first game
of
the year.
I'm sure he was probably listening to our last broadcast.
He probably has. Got a foul on Carson Frakes there for the arm bar.
So Yoder now with inbound duties. Out to O'Neill near half court. Now Vikings Schumacher to the set.
Zone out of that inbounds.
Luke Johnson, number 25, into the ballgame for the first time for the Vikings. They try to go high-low again. The ball tipped around. It's been a greased pig here for the Vikings in the second half.
You mentioned in the first half, as Yoder hits the runner, you mentioned in the first half the Vikings were getting the better of the 50-50 balls, and that has certainly switched here in the second half as the Titans have gotten every one of them.
One-point ball game now. Lob inside to Martin, and I don't know what that one was. Micah missed the dunk, but they're at least going to get a foul on O'Neill. Viking fans want the basket counted, but I don't think so.
No.
So I think Micah,
the only one in the cylinder was Micah.
Number two.
Micah now with 7 tonight. Check it, 6.
Short on that one. Ball tipped around. It'll end up in the hands of Wallen. And the Titans will go to work with 16.5 to play. And Augustana up by 2, 38-36. Lampis is going to take it all the way to the bucket. Squares up, gets the left-handed shot to go from the right side of the bucket.
Yeah, he got Pauly on
38.
Got Pauly on his hip a little bit, and Jacob was off balance and couldn't really challenge the shot. Now Yoder's going to pick up the touch foul near half court.
First on Luke Yoder. 13 foul on the Titans as he'll check out now. Wolf in. Vikings get McDonald and Ferguson and Pauly into the ballgame. Augie just 1 of 4 in the second half. Titans 2 of 7. Johnson gonna work past the free throw line, kicks it right back out to Wofford. Under 15 on the shot clock. Wofford gonna go to work on Wallen now, runs through him. Oh, that's a weak call. Typically, we don't complain about calls, but that's a bad one. Wallen got away with one there as he slid underneath Pearson on that one.
Third foul on Pearson Wofford.
Yeah, that's big. That's the third on Wofford. You are correct. Tough call there for the Vikes. Tied at 38 now. 15:45 to play. O'Neill going to take it to the corner, give it up to Wolf. Back to Wallen. He works on Wofford, shot up, and we're going to get a late foul call. That'll be 4 on Pearson Wofford.
Said he got him on the elbow, Chris.
We'll let you make your own decision there. First one for Wallen, rattles around and out. So the Vikings going to get tested here without Wofford in the ballgame for quite some time. He'll check out. Frakes in, Elledge in. Wallen gets 1 of 2, and the Titans have their first lead here in the second half, 39-38. McDonald now at the helm, goes far side to Frakes. Good defense extended by the Titans. Vikings need to work some back door here, take some pressure off. Pauly's going to take the 3, around and out. All Titans for the rebound, but they knock it out of bounds.
Yeah, Vikings got a break there. As you said, it was all Titans on the glass, but they couldn't control it. Vikings have really started to bog down defensively, or offensively, I should say, now under 40% from the field.
Pauley takes the lob out front to reignite the Augie offense, forces the pass into Ferguson, into a double team of Titans there. And Wolf's going to come the other way. He'll give it up to O'Neal. O'Neal will spin down low on Ferguson. Shot up and good, and it's a three-point tight lead. Momentum now shifting to the favor of Illinois Wesleyan. Big lob over the top, and they're going to get a hold on O'Neal. That's a
long pass, Chris. Yep. I would call that a high-risk, low-reward pass, because even Donovan makes the catch, he's still in a tough spot.
Lucas Simon will come in for Jacob Pauley. Charlie Bear hustles to the scorer's table. He'll get Alex O'Neal. And then we'll see freshman Cody Mitchell come back in for Doug Wallen. 41-38, Titans with the lead here. Still a ton of time to play, 14-48. Elledge through the lane to pick up the ball. Has it knocked away by Bear, gets it back. Goes cross court, Frakes in the lane. He'll take the little jumper and good. Carson Frakes gets his first bucket of the day.
And that's Carson's first bucket since the opening game of the year against Oshkosh when he had 10 points.
They went 5-for-10 in that one. Going to get an offensive foul called on Mitchell now on the screen. That's three on Cody Mitchell, the freshman out of St. Charles East. 15 foul on the Titans.
One good thing in the Vikings' favor, Chris, with the foul trouble on Pearson Wofford and having to go some time probably without him. Vikings have a pretty good rotation behind him in Frakes and Bodorf.
He's your leading scorer, though. Wow.
Well, I'm not saying it's a good thing. I'm trying to look at the bright side.
Frakes with a take and the swooping one-handed layup, and Augie back to the lead, 42-41. This one's been tight outside of a 10-point Augie lead, but that was quickly handled by the Titans. That time, Simon, I think, again, is going to get the block. O'Neal checks back in for Mitchell. Neither team has a score in double figures. Balanced scoring, though, throughout. 9 for Wallen, 8 for Elledge still. Lambis is going to kick it back to Wolf. 5 on the shot clock now. Schumacher going to have to create something. Kicks it off to Lambis. He'll fade away too hard. O'Neal, though, with the offensive rebound. Schumacher cuts. Tried to dip it one more time. Knocked away. Here come the Vikings. McDonald in transition. 3 rattles around. Big time rebound by Micah Martin, and then threw it out with the left hand.
Wow.
Didn't have a lot on it. Picked off by the Titans.
Yeah, Micah made a great play coming up with that offensive rebound and then just couldn't get the kick out cleanly.
O'Neal draws a ton of traffic, kicks it to Bear, and he'll be fouled. I'm not sure if the basket went in or not.
It did not. Going to get Austin Elledge with the block.
Austin was in the restricted area. So Bear will head to the free throw line. First on Elledge. Team fouls tied at 5 now with just over 13 minutes to play in the second half.
Chris, although the shot didn't go in, I was glad to see McDonald take that open three in transition. Like you said, I'd like to see him build on that good offensive game that he had against McMurray the other night.
Luke Johnson back in for the Vikings, and Coach G putting the chips in, Dan. He's got Pearson Wofford back in the game with 4 fouls.
13 minutes to go.
1-point ball game. Back in favor now of the Titans. Clock ticks under 13 minutes. McDonald works on Wolf. Back to Wofford. His three, good.
Pearson probably figures, not sure how many minutes I got left, but better get it done.
Back to a 2-point Augustana lead. Bear now squares up on Wofford. They'll go right at Pearson. Back to O'Neal. Got Pearson in the air, but dropped a tough pass to O'Neal to handle. The Vikings wanted 3 seconds. Shot up and good. That's Schumacher with the three.
Both of the threes that Schumacher have hit have been, I wouldn't say that was really contested, but it was well out on the floor, and it wasn't off the catch.
Back to a one-point Illinois Wesleyan lead. 12-10 to go. Luke Johnson trying to work the lob to Martin, knocked out of bounds by the Titans. Augie will have 10 on the shot clock.
Charlie Bear lobbying the official that the ball went off of McDonald's leg, or Johnson's leg, rather. And there you see.
Almost picked it. Yeah. They know that play, but that leaves Luke Johnson open. He misses the three.
Vikings just cannot knock down the threes tonight after being so good the past five games.
Well, Pearson just knocked one down, but not consistently.
Five,
right.
5 of 21 for the right. game, Chris.
Bear goes to work. Tough up and under on Micah Martin. Good.
Mike, I thought, did a pretty good job. He stayed down and made it a tough shot. And just give Bear credit for knocking it down.
48-45, Illinois Wesleyan now. 11 and a half to play, and we're going to get a foul on O'Neal as he and Micah continue to battle in the low post. Jelen will check in. Laritz back in for the Titans. Back to a 20-second shot clock for the Vikings as Jelen weaves his way through. He'll take the 16-foot jumper around. No good, but we're going to get a foul as Micah Martin went to the ground. If they're going to get Laritz or, nope, they're going to get Bear. So Bear picks up his second, and that will send Micah Martin to the line for a 1-1.
Yeah, the Vikings now in the bonus. Micah 2 of 3 from the line tonight. He's got 6 points along with 6 rebounds and 3 blocks.
Misses the front end, but they're going to get a lane violation on Wolf.
Looks like Wolf may have backed off the lane.
He might have been behind the 3-point arc and he stepped in.
Ah, okay.
I think that's what it was.
Because where he was standing when the official pointed at him, it would have been like the second defensive slot.
Right.
Unfortunately, the Vikings can't make him pay for it. Front end 1-1 means an empty possession.
So the Titans with a ball and a 3-point lead now as Laritz hands off to Wolf. Bounce pass to Schumacher. He'll curl into the corner to Laritz. He'll step back to catch the three and it goes out of the corner. Biggest lead of the day so far for the Titans. It's 6.
First three of the year from Matt Laritz.
51-45. Lob over the top and they're going to get another foul on Laritz.
Vikings got to make hay at the free throw line, though.
Yeah, you definitely got to.
So those aren't bad fouls if you can't make them pay by making some free throws.
Laritz picks up his first 8th team foul on the Titans. 10:53 to play in the ball game. So just 1 of 4 there for Micah in the last two possessions for the Vikings. 51-46, put some pressure on the Viking defense here now to get some stops. Lambesis inside the elbow, going to get the jumper, no good, but a rebound.
Yeah, both Vikings challenged the shot, and it didn't leave anyone there to block off Laritz.
And a timeout called by Schumacher inside, right near the Titan bench. And this one will be a full Titan timeout. All right, that'll give us a chance. We'll take a quick break here. 10:32 to play. We'll be back with more Augustana basketball right after this.
Is it riskier to build your way to growth or buy your way? We have ideas. Find them at wehaveideas.firstmidwest.com. First Midwest Bank.
Sunday afternoon basketball in the CCIW here in Rock Island. It is 51-46, Illinois Wesleyan, after these two teams were tied at 34 at the half.
Chris, I want to congratulate Coach Mark Beinborn's Augustana women on a big victory over a top 25 Illinois Wesleyan team today. The Vikings won that one 86-80. Alexis Jones, big game for the Vikings, 24 points, 14 rebounds, 5 assists, and 6 steals. Vikings zone out of that inbounds play.
Lambis is going to try to get inside, yeah, 4 on the shot clock. Wolf going to be forced to put it up now, and can't get it off. Good D out of the timeout there by the Vikings.
And actually, I take that back. It appears the Vikings were in man-to-man. Pearson Woffen back on the bench now, Chris.
Yeah, Pearson with 4 fouls. Alex O'Neill playing with 4 for the Titans. Jelen in trouble now, gets it to Frakes. Frakes picks up the dribble right back to Jelen. 10 on the shot clock. Frakes tries to work off the edge there, and he'll draw the foul on Bear. And that's more free throws for the Vikings. So that's 3 on Charlie Bear, although Life Stats have him for 4. Interesting. We'll go with 3.
Frakes 0 for 1 from the line this year. As we said, he has not had not played much since the first game of the year.
Vikings cannot get the job done at the free throw line. Unfortunately, that time, though, Titans couldn't control the rebound.
We'll see if the Titans overplay this lob, inbounds lob, and the Vikings switch it up.
5 of 9 for the Vikings from the free throw line. Just 2 of 6 here in the second half. Elledge going to get a clean look and hits the 3.
First 3 of the night for Austin, and he's the first Viking in double figures with 11.
First player from either team with double figures, and it's a 2-point ball game now. And they're going to get Jelen as he got into the face of Grant Wolf there.
Yeah, we've questioned some of the calls tonight. That would not have been one of them. So Jack just reached out and grabbed Wolf.
Wolf now splits, goes to the left hand, knocked away though by Jelen. Grant had to, Wolf had to slow down because Ferguson was coming on the help side. So good job there by the Vikings. Chance to take the lead back or tie here. Jelen going to try to tie. Off the glass, no good. Gets his own rebound though.
Jack Jelen everywhere in this last sequence. A foul, a steal, a shot, and a rebound.
Elledge with the double pump. That's a tough shot. Not a great one. Rebound
again,
to Wallen.
Again, that's what happens when you're more interested in trying to draw contact than you are in just making a shot.
Yoder going to back it out. Goes to Wolf now near side. Take by Wallen in the lane. Couple pivots. Kicks it back to Schumacher. He's going to take the deep 3. Too hard, yep. And they're going to get a foul as Jelen pushed Bear in the back to run him underneath the iron there.
Third foul on Jelen.
7th team foul on the Vikings. Pauly and Martin will check back in.
Number 7.
Bear 3 of 4 at the line tonight. He's got 5 points. Vikings have done a good job keeping him off the glass. He came in averaging 10 rebounds a game, just 3. Titans have slowly whittled away. Early was a huge rebound deficit. Rebounding numbers are 34-26 in the Vikings' favor right now.
Wofford back in for the Vikings. And he'll pull, Martin will pull down that rebound. 3-point ball game, 52-49 in favor of the Titans, 8:40 to play. Just the second CCIW contest for the Vikings. Titans are 1-1 as they've lost to Wheaton and then came back and beat a highly ranked Carthage team. That time just lost the handle on a bad turnover as Noe just takes away the dribble. 12th turnover for the Vikings. No working on Pauly, and he'll be called for the travel in the low post there.
nice Titan turnover.
Yep. McDonald back in. Two freshmen there battle, as we talked about, Yoder and McDonald. Kick into the corner to Jellin. He's double teamed back. Pauly will take the three. Missed everything.
Tell that
heading out of bounds. Yoder does a nice job to screen away Micah Martin.
Yeah, I could tell that Jacob Pauly's shot was well off the mark when he let it go.
Full timeout called by the Vikings. We'll take another break. 7:43 to play. Stick around. The Vikings trail by three. .43 to play at this one in Rock Island, and the Titans lead the Vikings 52-49. Chris Ford, along with Dan Sand, executive producer Kyle Eckberg, here with you. A little Sunday afternoon basketball here in the CCIW. As we mentioned, the Vikings will play the next two following Sundays in a row. They'll play in the Wisconsin Intercollegiate Athletic Conference. So they'll get lacrosse. And who else?
Stevens Point.
Stevens Point, both ranked teams.
Combined about 12-1 between them.
Well, that time the Titans break the Vikings off press. No, though, air balls to three.
Most open look he's had all night.
Yeah, they did everything right but the shot there.
Now we see McDonald and Jellin on the floor for the first time, I think, since the first couple games of the year.
McDonald runs through, kicks out to Jellin. He's going to load the three too hard. Rebound to Wofford. He'll put it right back up and in.
First person had to wrestle away from Jacob Pauly, though.
1 point lead now, 52-51. Wofford into double figures with 11. Pauly cranking up the defense there on Noe. Schumacher.
Good
bear.
Good job by Jellin to close out on Schumacher.
No, runs through the lane, puts up the two. No good. Picked up ball by Wofford. He cranks it up, and then he'll draw the foul on No. So, or excuse me, yeah, on Corey No.
And that's the 10th team foul. So now the Vikings will be shooting two.
And this is the guy you want at the free throw line if you're the Vikings, 89% free throw shooter.
Yeah, he's been the Vikings' best all year from the line.
Number 10.
Pearson also with a game-high 8 rebounds tonight in addition to his 11 points.
Grant Wolf, Peter Lambesis, Alex O'Neill in for the Titans. Vikings get Austin Ellidge in, Lucas Simon in.
Yeah, Chris, as you know, you come down the stretch in tight games. I think if you had to pick a Viking that you're looking to make plays, I think Pearson would be your number one guy.
Yeah, and so far, knock on wood, he's played with four fouls. Coach G sat him a couple times. That one missed, though. Knocked out of bounds, and it'll go to the Titans.
So the Vikings' free throw shooting woes extend even to their best free throw shooter, Pearson Wofford.
I'll say again, O'Neill plays with four for the Titans. Wofford with four for the Vikings.
Yeah, that's not a trade-off I'm willing
no,
to make.
I agree. Tied at 52, under 6.5 to go now. Wolf takes it to the top of the key. They look for the backdoor cut by Lambesis, well guarded by Wofford. 10 on the shot clock now. Lambesis with the spin move at the elbow, goes to the right hand, caught at the bottom of the rim, though.
Made a nice move. I just don't think he got quite as far to the other side of the basket as he needed to.
High ball screen now by McDonald. Skip pass across to Simon. Now near side Wofford. Tries to get through Wallen, and the foul will be called on the Titans, Doug Wallen.
Third on Wallen, Chris. Pearson's going to go back to the line for two.
Vikings take back the lead on the free throw by Wofford. Around and out again, just 1-2 for Pearson. 1 point Augie lead. We go under 6 minutes to play now. Freshman Luke Yoder guarded by McDonald. Far side they go. Now they're going to work Wallen on Lucas Simon. His shot up. Catches the front of the iron, rebound pulled down by Pearson. Big minutes played here by Pearson with four fouls. McDonald runs through, wide open Austin Ellidge, around and out. Ball tipped away through the hands of Lambesis.
Credit Micah Martin for keeping it alive, Chris.
Second chance opportunity for the Vikings here with under 5.5 to play now. Wofford in the lane, kicks out to McDonald, thought about the three.
Didn't shoot it in rhythm again, Chris. Either shoot it or don't shoot it, but once you hesitate, reset.
Third opportunity for the Vikings now. We're going to get a foul on Lambesis as he got on the arm of Lucas Simon there. So Lucas will head to the free throw line for the Vikings. Augie just 4-10 in the second half. That's not good in any ball game, but certainly more critical in a one-point ball game.
Lucas' first trip to the free throw line this year.
Yeah. They're going to check back in for Wallen. So 1-2 again. Last three trips to the line, the Vikings have gone 1-2. Wofford going to check out again. Frake's going to come in. Augie back to a two-point lead, 5:14 to go. Yoder comes near side to Lambesis. They got Frakes on Bear. I think that would be an opportunity they'd want to take advantage of. Bear now with the up and under, and it goes.
Yeah, Mike was just a little late getting there on help.
Tied at 54. Lob inside to Martin. He'll lunge towards the basket, misses the shot. Rebound taken down by Bear. Big step by Micah, not squared up. Couldn't get it to go, tied at 54, 4.5 to play. Lambesis back into Bear, another opportunity. This time, Ellidge helps and the ball's thrown away, out of bounds by Bear. So the Vikings do a nice little adjustment there and run the double in the form of Austin Ellidge and stop Bear, and then he throws it away.
Coach G doing a little offense defense with Pearson Wofford. Usually see that late, a little bit later in the game, but the dead balls have played out where he's had a chance to do that a little bit.
That's nice, but Pearson's also been effective rebounding tonight, as you mentioned, so you like to have him on the floor there, too, on the defensive end. Ellidge with the hard take and square, can't get it to go, but he'll draw the foul on freshman Luke Yoder.
It's kind of painful. The Vikings have done a great job of getting in the bonus and getting to the free throw line and just haven't been able to knock them down.
Let's see.
Hopefully
if
Austin can get the lid off here.
Yep. Ellidge, an 83% free throw shooter.
Just six attempts, though, all year coming into this. As we said, he missed the first four games with an injury, or he missed four games with an injury. I don't think they were the first four.
There you go. Bodies on the floor there. Ellidge makes it a two-point ball game in favor of the Vikings with 4:08 to play.
And Carson Frakes checked back in place of Pearson Wofford as the Vikings buy another possession.
Just what we guaranteed you, a good ball game, 4 minutes to play, two-point Augustana lead. Wolf operates on the far side, now in the high post to Bear. Wolf in the lane, guarded by Frakes, brings it out. Gonna take a run at Carson. Nice crossover, runs, kick out. O'Neal gonna take the baseline jumper, missed everything. Ball loose on the floor, picked up by Wolf. This two is good.
Well, that one hurts. The Vikings got, I think, a shot that they would have been fairly happy with, an 18-foot jumper by O'Neal that was well off the mark, and they just couldn't get the rebound.
O'Neal now defends Martin. Jelen comes near side to Frakes, to Ellidge. He'll get the screen. Skip pass to Jelen, and again for the second time tonight, Vikings got players playing out of bounds. Crucial turnover there for the Vikings. McDonald gonna check in for Jelen. Tied at 56. This possession could take us under 3 minutes. And Wolf's gonna get a timeout. And the Titans are going to talk about it. This will be a full one with 3:08 to play. All right, we will take another break. Tied at 56, 3:08 to go. More Augustana basketball after this timeout. Crawled back into it after the opponent's respective leads here. But right now, the final 3:08 is going to decide this as we're tied with Titan basketball. 15 on the shot clock now as the Vikings get into a little bit of a zone here,
yep.
Dan.
Yep. I was just waiting for some movement in the office, this offense, to see whether the Vikings were man or zone.
Kick back out on top, knocked away by Lucas Simon. On the ground, now picked up by Simon. He'll go to the bucket, has it stripped away, and they're going to get a foul on Yoder. Well, my only concern on that play is I'm not sure I appreciate the fact that a Viking got on the floor there, but the shot clock was going to run out anyway.
I think they would have had a shot clock violation, but I don't think you can take that for granted in that place, in that situation. And as it turned out, the Vikings get a free throw opportunity out of it. Now, whether they can make it pay off is another story.
I was just more concerned that the foul might be called there.
Right.
Wofford going to check back in for Frakes. Back to a one-point Augie lead, 2:44 to go. Lucas gets both to go. He's got nine for the Vikings. A lot of damage done for him at the free throw line. 2-point Viking lead. 2.5 to play now here at the Carver Center. Schumacher gonna penetrate, goes right at Martin, tried to leave it for Bear, picked off by Ellidge. Vikings have numbers. Austin gonna run into the corner, leaves it for Simon. Cross court skip pass, McDonald's gonna put up the three, around and out.
But you know that time, Chris, he shot it in rhythm. Didn't get it to go, but much better than a couple of times tonight when he's hesitated before pulling the trigger.
One more timeout here for the Titans of Illinois Wesleyan. See if we're gonna keep it here. Nope, it's gonna be another full timeout. We'll take one more break, 2:08 to play. Vikings with a 2-point lead.
Is it riskier to build your way to growth or buy your way? We have ideas. Find them at wehaveideas.firstmidwest.com. First Midwest Bank.
To play, two-point ball game. Dan, a couple things that stood out to me as I looked through the stats. Vikings still a plus 10 on the boards. When's the last time Augie took more three-point attempts in a ball game?
Exactly the same one that I, and not just taking more, but 11 more.
Yeah.
Vikings just 6 of 27 from three-point range. Titans 9 of 16. Yeah, that is a total turnaround from the way these teams usually play.
Wolf now takes the inbounds pass. Full shot clock for the Titans. Up high to O'Neal. They have O'Neal and Bear still in the ball game. They get it posted up low, almost thrown away. Schumacher going to get a clean look at a three.
Pretty much
rolls in.
Pretty much knew when he had that open a look that he was going to knock it down.
Titans back in the lead by one.
Thought Austin Ellidge was going to be able to get to that kind of weak kickout pass from Bear.
Vikings having problems getting it inside the arc here. Simon going to leave it for Ellidge. He'll take the 16-footer. Soft touch, got it to go. 60-59, 1:25 to play in the ball game now.
15 for Austin tonight. Right on his average since he's moved into the starting lineup.
O'Neal fakes the handoff. They're working Bear hard down low on Wofford, who's got four. Now O'Neal behind the arc. Still plenty of time, 12 on the shot clock. Freshman Yoder to the bucket, blocked by Martin. And what a save by Lucas Simon. Big time block and save as the Viking defense comes alive there on that possession. Mark, under a minute to play now.
Mark that one down, Chris, if the Vikings can pull this one out.
1 point Viking lead, 45 seconds to play in the ballgame. 10 on the shot clock now. Ellidge stops. He's going to hit that 15-footer. No good. Tipped out of bounds by Micah Martin.
I think Austin had a chance to take that one down the right side of the lane and get to the glass, but decided to pull up instead. And he shot it pretty well with that pull-up jumper tonight, so you can't criticize that decision.
One more timeout for Ron Rose. So 33.8 on the game clock, 27 seconds on the shot clock. We'll keep it here in this full timeout.
6.8 seconds difference.
Well, I got to believe, I'm going to just speculate here on Titans' side of things. I think that Charlie Bear matchup on Pearson Wofford, it's better for the Vikings, but I still think that's a spot they're going to look to go, and if it's not there, maybe a kick out.
Yeah, I think, I don't want to speak for Ron Rose, but Charlie Bear would not be my first offensive option for them. Maybe in a kick out situation, but I'm not sure that he would be my first choice to take a shot when you have playmakers like Schumacher on the floor.
Take a look at the scoring for the Vikings. Ellidge has 15, Wofford has 13. Still no Titans in double figures, but as we said before, excellent balanced scoring from both teams. Schumacher has 9, Wallen has 9. 8 for Bear.
Interesting note, Chris. You mentioned no Titans in double figures. They, in their loss to Wheaton, they had no players in double figures. And I believe I was told, I haven't checked this, but it was the first time that they had done that at home since something like 2002 or 2001. But you know what? All that matters is the W. And if Ron Rose can get a bucket out of here and leaves with no one in double figures, I'm sure he would not care in the least.
Interesting, I saw Pearson Wofford go right to the official and talk to him about something. This time the Vikings
said, don't call a foul on me.
Yeah. So no, they don't have two big men in there, so this time Wofford gets Wallen. Backdoor cut. We're going to get a block by Pauly, but a foul on Pauly. And the block crowd wants a goaltend, but certainly not. Take a look on the replay there. Not a goaltend.
So one of the rare instances when both fan sections are complaining, the Vikings complaining on the foul call and the Titans complaining on the no goaltend. Looks like Lambesis at the line, 71% coming in on the year. He's 2-2 tonight.
Still 25.1 on the game clock.
So plenty of time for the Vikings if Lambesis knocks this one down to give the Titans the lead.
He rattles in both big free throws there, 61-60 Titans. 25.1 to play. Vikings with the ball. A two-pointer will win it. Jack thought about maybe going all the way to the bucket there. Wofford going to take the three. Oh, rattles off the top. Martin pulls it away. Scores it. Oh, don't call that on Micah. Good.
No.
I was going to say, Micah came in and took it over the top.
There was a couple calls I was wondering about there. A, was it going to be on Micah? A, was it going to be a foul on Wesleyan? Or a third option was they could have called a travel there as Micah got tied up.
That shot just hung on the rim,
yeah,
though, from Pearson Walker.
Yeah,
you could see him. He watched it and kind of babied it in with the stroke.
It couldn't have been any more tantalizing than that before it rolled off. Now, Micah will get two here as the Vikings are in the double bonus.
6.2 to play, so the Titans are going to get the ball back here if Micah can make this one. ...61-60 Illinois Wesleyan, 6.2 to play. Martin with the second one, banks that one in.
Just like a drill up.
Banks are not open on Sunday. But today in Rock Island, they are.
He drew it up.
Wow. What a ball game. 61 apiece. 6.2 to play. And a full timeout now called by Augustana. So we'll catch our breath. Don't go away. Big finish coming up. Tied at 61, and Dan, I got to believe no matter the outcome of this game, the Vikings are going to look at the free throw stat, 13 to 21, just 62%.
Well, shooting across the board tonight, Chris. Let's get this last play, hopefully the last play of regulation in here, and we'll talk a little bit about that. Going to be Wallen on the inbound.
He'll be able to run the end line there.
Yeah, and imagine the ball's going to be in Schumacher's, hands.
Into the hands of Wolf now.
Fastest of the
four to play. Wolf with the crossover. Going to fade away from three. No good. We're headed to overtime.
So we've got two CCIW games this year, and both of them going to overtime. What I was going to say, Chris, is shows that we don't really know what the heck we're talking about, because the two keys that we talked about in the pregame, Chris, was rebounding and keeping the turnovers down. And you look at the Vikings numbers and they're plus 12 on the boards and they've only committed 13 turnovers. You would have thought they'd have been in pretty good shape.
Well, we assume that though, based on how well they'd shot the ball, that wasn't an issue coming into the game.
That's kind of the point I was trying to make, Chris.
The shooting
has gone south, not just from the free throw line. Look at the Viking numbers overall are awful this afternoon. 36% overall from the field, 21% from three-point range, which is about half of what they've been shooting this year, and just 62% from the free throw line. So that's the kind of the point I was making. They had shot the ball so well recently, and it is that's completely gone south, and I think quite honestly, you look at those shooting numbers and you're probably pretty happy to be going to overtime at this point. The effort's been great, but the fact that they've controlled the boards as well as they have tonight is an indication of that. But the shots just haven't fallen, including from the free throw line. And hopefully, the extra 5 minutes, they can rectify that.
Every player into the ballgame except Cody Mitchell for the Titans has scored. They've got three players with nine, Schumacher, Lambesis, and Wallen.
I think, Chris, 6 seconds, 6.2 seconds or whatever it was, I think it was enough time to get a better shot than the Titans got off, don't you think?
Well, I mean, he had some space. It was a step back three. Yeah, I would give it a B, you know. All right, we're going to play 5 extra minutes here. Tied at 61, we're headed to overtime number one.
Pearson Wofford, Charlie Bear, and Alex O'Neill still all playing with four fouls.
Yeah, I'm not sure that Charlie Bear one is accurate. I think...
Oh, that's the one that was in the scrim up
for
right?
Three, yeah.
Okay.
This time jump there, and the Viking by Bear.
And credit Coach G and Pearson for keeping him on the
big
floor.
Big time. Big time job there.
He picked up that fourth foul, I think, with 13 and a half minutes left or something like that.
There's the foul on Bear. That'll be his fourth.
Or actually, he might have gone back in with 13 and a half minutes left. I can't remember. Something along those lines. There was still a lot of time left when he picked up that fourth foul. And Coach G and credit Pearson as well for really managing his playing time and keeping him on the floor.
Well, here we are back to the free throw line, and this time Micah hits the first one.
Yeah, Micah had come in 53% on the year, and that's pretty much right on. He's 5-9 tonight.
Vikings got more to the free throw line in the first half than the Titans did combined in both halves, 18-12. 1 point Augustana lead here to open up overtime. Wallen going to go down low. Kick out, Wolf in the lane. Micah Kane, crowd wanted to travel on Bear. Yoder in the corner. Five on the shot clock. Wolf going to go all the way to the bucket. What a block right into the hands of Wallen. His three up, no good. Ball tipped around. One more time picked up by Jones.
Boy, you'd hate to see that defensive possession by the Vikings and have them not come away with that.
Lob inside to Martin, stripped from the backside by Schumacher.
He can't bring it down. Can't bring that ball down there.
4:07 to go, overtime. 23 seconds on the shot clock. Yoder with good defense, got a hand in the lane there.
Yeah, the Vikings went away from that lob that they usually do that we saw the Titans read and try and steal in the first half. So we've seen the Vikings kind of go away from that a couple times here in the second half.
Jellin now gets it right back out on top. 12 to go on the clock. Schumacher guards him. Jellin going to lob over the top. Tough pass caught by Martin. Squares up and gets it to go.
Wow, not exactly that way. I'm sure they drew that one up either, but it plays out in the Vikings' favor.
3-point Augie lead. Just over 3.5 to play now. Wallen going to stop at the free throw line. Schumacher runs into Martin. Micah been effective on the defensive end tonight. Good job there moving his feet. Now Wolf gets around him. Five on the shot clock. Oh, what a beautiful shot. A little underhand, soft touch by Wolf. Gets it to go. It's a 1 point Augie lead now, 64-63. What do you call that, a little scoop shot?
Yeah, that would be a scoop shot.
A little soft scoop shot. Ellard's jumper off the opposite side of the glass. Titans have it back, trailing by one, under three to play. Yoder now in with the left hand, gonna kick out. Bear will take the three. That one goes, and that's a big three. Bear gives the Titans a 2-point lead, 66-64.
So the Titans tonight have seen Matt Larratt hit his first three of the year, and Charlie Bear hit his first three of the year.
Timeout called by the Vikings, 2:32 to play, 66-64. Well, Dan, the strategic wheels have been spinning for quite some time on both sides here. So we had a plethora of timeouts to end regulation, and now another one here with a two-point ball game with 2:32 to play. Jelen, Ellidge, Wofford, Simon, and Martin for the Vikings. Wolf, Yoder, Lambesis, Bear, and O'Neill now for the visiting Titans. Pearson out on top, no go there. Now he'll work on Bear. Fade away in the lane. Bear got a hand on it, partially knocked out of bounds, and it will go to the Titans. Tough shot there by Pearson Wofford.
Yeah, a shot that Pearson's very comfortable taking, though. He just, I don't know if he was altered or whether Wallen did get a piece of it, but not Wallen. Not sure who was.
Lambesis
was defending him, okay. But left it short.
So 2 minutes to play now. Titans with the ball and a two-point lead. Knocked away by Wofford. Gets on the ground, and it'll be a jump ball. Possession arrow in favor of Illinois Wesleyan. Pearson was headed to the races quickly on that one. Lost the handle after the initial steal, though.
I'm sure the discussion will be
shot clock,
right?
I'm not sure there was ever a change of possession.
16. Officials agreed with you, Chris.
Schumacher going to get in for Lambesis. So you got Yoder, Wolf, and Schumacher from the outside, and you got O'Neill and Bear on the inside. 10 to go here. Bear looks for the handoff, well defended by Lucas Simon, and the Vikings switch. Yoder with the runner, blocked again by Micah Martin with two on the shot clock.
Sixth block of the night for Micah, Chris.
.139 to play, two on the shot clock. Lob way out on top. O'Neill's going to have to take it from half court. Wolf takes it, and that'll be a shot clock violation. Good job by the Vikings there. I think O'Neill obviously didn't know how much time was left on that shot clock.
Yeah, kind of a weird possession with 2 seconds on the shot clock that they would throw it that deep into the backcourt. And then, like you said, when O'Neill chased it down, he didn't really seem to have much of a sense of urgency.
The Vikings get the stop when they needed it. Now they need a bucket here with under a minute and a half to play. Long pass from Wofford to Ellidge. Back into the hands of Jelen. Jack with the spin move, goes cross court to Simon. Now they got Martin posted up on O'Neill. Steps into a lot of traffic. Shot missed. Rebound taken by the Titans.
Too much traffic there, Chris. I think you got to kick it out when you're facing three guys.
Neither team can score on their last possession here. Still a two-point Titan lead. Under a minute we go now. Titans going to hold it out plenty of time, though, but the Vikings need to get a stop. Wolf with a couple starts and stops, forces one up, blocked by Wofford, and again with 2 seconds, it'll go out of bounds to the Titans.
We've been here before, haven't we, Chris?
We have. 41.6 to play in overtime number one.
Deese is setting up for a lob in the lane. Now he screens for O'Neill.
They get it under to Bear, and he squeaks it in. Bear came from the weak side corner, snuck it in. 4-point lead for the Titans, 34 seconds to play. Vikings go inside. Martin with a tough shot, partially blocked. And the Titans in full control now. Wolf across the top of the key. They're just going to spread it out with 21 seconds. The Vikings need to find someone to foul here.
The clock is off.
So the Vikings go into Micah Martin twice. Can't convert into shots. And it's a two-possession ball game here with Wolf at the free throw line.
we talked to Chris in the Calvin game about how they made no adjustments and just played behind Mike and kind of let him work. Well, Wesleyan's not doing that, so those last two Viking possessions, I think, were obviously not...
Micah typically doesn't turn over his right shoulder to
ideal.
Shoot either. All right, Vikings in trouble here, down 6, 16 seconds to play. Going to have to get a couple threes up. Jelen, though, going to try to go to the bucket. Kicks it out. Wofford's three. Bingo. Three-point ball game. Still 9.9 to play. This one's not over yet. Quick timeout called by the Vikings. It's a full one. We'll keep it right here. Dan, this will give us a chance to take a look. I was going to mention before the game, Vikings and Wheaton were the only two undefeated teams in the CCIW after just three games, and that's certainly an issue for the Vikings right now. Wheaton 2-0, Elmhurst received their first loss yesterday as they lost at home to North Central. So Elmhurst is 1-1. Carthage 1-1, Carroll 1-1, Wesleyan 1-1, North Central 1-1, Milliken, North Park yet to have won a ball game. So all the more important reason that the Vikings needed the W here today.
Well, especially as we always talk about guarding the home court. So you hate to drop one at home, but unless the Vikings can make something happen here in the last 10 seconds, it looks like that might be exactly what happened.
We said the Vikings will go on the road in the Wisconsin Intercollegiate Athletic Conference on the next two Sundays, getting Stevens Point and La Crosse, both of those 3 o'clock ball games. Right now, 9.9 to go. Vikings need to find a way to get a turnover, something, down three. And Wolf's gonna get it in. Vikings don't foul him now, Ellidge does. So a couple free throws coming up here for Grant Wolf.
Wolf 81% on the year. As we mentioned, he had missed the last three games with an injury, but he's back here tonight. Put together a solid game, 10 points, 6 rebounds.
That's a big one right there. 4-point ball game now with 7.6 seconds to play. Five-point ball game now. Jelen gonna run it up the floor, 6-5. Gotta get a shot up. Can't get it to go, rebound, and that should do it as Jack Jelen fouls Grant Wolf. So 6/10 of a second left to play, and the Vikings gonna lose at home in the CCIW before a pretty daunting road trip here, where they'll play 8 of their next 9 on the road. And the next 4 against ranked teams. So not the way you wanted to see kind of this big home streak, 8 of 9, end up for Augie. Wolf gets both to go again, and that will put a nail in the coffin as Illinois Wesleyan has come into the Carver PE Center, and in overtime, beat the Augustana Vikings 74-67, so the Vikings pick up their first loss in CCIW play. They'll go to 1-1. Illinois Wesleyan moves to 2-1, and they will get the Wash U Bears next. Tough game for the Vikings, Dan.
Yeah, and interesting how it played out. The two keys that we talked about in the pregame really went the Vikings' favor, although you look at the final rebound numbers, and it's 46-42, so it wasn't as dominant as the Vikings have been earlier, but only turned it over 13 times, which is a number I think going into the game you've been very happy with, but you can't, it's tough to overcome 35% shooting overall, 24% from three-point range, and 61% from the free throw line, and if they had shot, you know, they had made one more free throw, obviously, in overtime or in regulation, we wouldn't have gone to overtime. So just not good enough shooting from a team that had shot extraordinarily well in five games. And you look at Wesleyan's defensive numbers coming in were not particularly good. They had allowed their opponents to shoot 48% and 38% from three. So just an unfortunate time to have a really bad shooting night for the Vikings, because they cleaned up some of the other areas you were worried about.
Yeah. The Vikings got to the free throw line, as you said, 23 times. Just 14 of 23, so that one does hurt. All right, I'll let you take a look at things individually here.
Yeah, 14 of 23 and only 11 of 20 after halftime. So, all right, for the victorious Titans, they were led by Grant Wolf, who had 14 points, including those last two free throws. Charlie Bear had 13. 9 points each for Keandre Schumacher and Peter Lambesis. 9 also for Doug Wallen. 6 for Corey Noe. 5 each for Matt Laritz and Luke Yoder, and 4 for Alex O'Neill to round out the Titans' total of 74. They shot just 39% from the field on 24-61, but they hit the ones that mattered, and those were from behind the arc, 11-20 for 55% from beyond the arc, and that's really where they got their offense from. Also, they got it done at the line, where the Vikings did 15 of 18 for the Titans, 83% from the line. For the Vikings, they were led by Pearson Wofford, who had 16 points, also had a game-high 11 rebounds, picked up his fourth foul with something on the order of 13 or 14 minutes to play, and never fouled out, so credit Pearson for that. 15 points for Austin Ellidge, 11 points, 8 rebounds, and 6 block shots for Micah Martin tonight. 9 points for Lucas Simon, 4 each for Carson Frakes and Donovan Ferguson, 3 for Jacob Pauley, 3 for Jack McDonald, and 2 for Jack Jellin to round out the Vikings' total of 16. As we mentioned, the Vikings struggled to 35% shooting from the field, just 23 of 65, and they were only 7 of 29 from three-point range for 24%. 14 of 23 from the free-throw line, 61%, but just 11 of 20 after halftime, and they missed a lot coming down the stretch of regulation when they could have hopefully at that point been kind of icing the game away and couldn't get it done. Rebounds went, as I said, in the Vikings' favor, 46 to 42, and each team turned it over 13 times. So I think from the turnover standpoint, the Vikings would have been really happy with that going in, but obviously not happy with the final result in this one.
Well, as we said from the beginning of the season, the Vikings had the first 8 of 9 at home, and the Vikings kind of finished that stretch 6-3. Can't emphasize how important Vikings play again on December 22nd. Not back here in the Carver PE Center until 1:15. So you lose at home, and then you got to go on the road for 5 tough games, 4 of those against ranked teams, 2 out of the WEAC and 2 out of the CCIW in Carthage and Elmhurst. So I think we will learn an awful lot about what this season holds for the Vikings come January 15th.
Yeah, I think it's a tall task ahead, there's no question. And we know when it comes time for NCAA selections and such, it's a pretty narrow margin. And now you're looking at 3 losses before the first of the year, with 2 very tough games ahead of you before the first of the year. Could get pretty dicey at that point. But you know what, the old cliche, one at a time. That's all you can do is look at the game ahead of you, and the next one is Stevens Point on the road on the 22nd.
The other way you can look at it after a loss is no better way to get into the contention for the NCAA than to play top-ranked teams and win those ball games.
Certainly help you down the line, assuming that both La Crosse and Stevens Point end up in the regional rankings at the end of the year.
All right, well, that's going to wrap it up for this one, I guess. Dan and I wish you happy holidays again, because we won't talk to you till mid-January. Vikings move to 6-3, 1-1 in the CCIW. Next time we'll talk to you, it'll be January 15th back here in the Carver PE Center. So for Dan Sand, this is Chris Ford, and our executive producer, Kyle Eckberg. We say goodnight to you from Rock Island.